bombers and terrorists. And we don't need anything to do with these people. They don't believe in God. They're worshiping a black box out in the desert. They don't believe anything worthwhile, and they're kissing the ground 5 times a day. And my father said, no, you got to meet this man. He's so nice. He's very nice. And I said, I'm not going to do it. My father insisted, and I said, all right, well, I'll do it my way. But my way is to go to church, and I'll come straight from church. It has to be on a Sunday. He said, okay, we can do that. And I want to meet him in our business place. He said, okay, we can do that. And I said, I'm going to go to church. I'm going to get really charged up from all of the, you know, good stuff. And I'm going to have my hat. He said, Jesus is Lord. I'll have my salib, my cross with me. I'll have my book, my Bible. My wife, the born-again Christian, she'll be with me. And we'll get in here. We're going to, you know, defend the, you know, the American Christian religion here, so to speak. Yeah. I was anticipating that we're going to meet, you know, Ayatollah Khomeini. This was the one we knew the most about, was Islam. You know, you see these Shiite Muslims, and they were, you know, wearing these black turbans and cloaks on them and long dresses and big beards. And so I imagine this is going to be somebody with a sword or something, you know. Place of business, and my father said, here he is. And I looked and I said, this is the man. He's just normal looking. He has regular clothes. He doesn't have a beard. He didn't have any hair at all. And I said, what is this, you know? And I met him, what's your name? Muhammad, very nice. And I told him my name. I said, by the way, do you believe in God? Immediately I'm in the subject of religion, because of course I have to defend the religion. And he said, yeah. And I said, oh, I thought they didn't believe in God, you know. And he said, well, yeah. And I asked him about Abraham. He said, yeah, he believed in Abraham. And I started telling the story of Ismail and Ishaq, you know, Isaac and Ishmael. Only, of course, the Christian Bible has it backwards. It said his oldest son was sacrificed, or, you know, but then it has a comma, it said, which was Isaac. Somebody must have added that, you know. His oldest son was sacrificed, which was Isaac. And that's what it says in Genesis, by the way. And if you read the story, you know it wasn't his oldest son. He already told you the oldest son was who. But this is immaterial. The man didn't argue with me on the point, by the way. In fact, all the time I knew him, he never, ever debated with me about anything. I debated with him. I tried my best to get him in a debate. And I would win every debate. Because I wouldn't take anything I didn't know the subject, you know. I feel like I'm really accomplished at arguing. But in reality, he won. Because I agreed, let's have this man come and do business with us. And in fact, after I saw him for a while, I liked his personality, his way. I said, we need to save him, you know. My father told me, leave him alone, you know, he's fine like he is. I said, no, I got to save this man. And I asked my father, could he come and live with us? My father said, all right. So I invited him to live with us. And I said, but I don't want to insult him, so let's charge him a small amount that we know he can afford, because I think maybe he's miskeen, poor, because he told me he wanted to stay in his mosque for a while. That was during Ramadan, you see. And I thought, oh my God, he must be, anybody stays in a church, my God, they're poor, you know. And I said, oh, I thought he was, you know, somebody, he's a geologist, he's all these things, but he's staying in a mosque, oh my God. So I invited him to come live with us. He said, are you sure? I said, yeah. It cost you $15 a week. He said, okay. I said, everybody only include the food. Because I don't want to lose him, right? And he said, okay. And I didn't want to scratch his dignity, though. You know, I wanted to make it look nice. And so he accepted. But on his side, he has money. He doesn't need that. But he's looking at me like, what is this guy doing, you know? So he accepted, and he came, and he stayed with us. Now, exactly at the same time that was happening, another person who I'd known for a long time, a friend who was a preacher of Christianity, sort of an odd person, he liked to take a big cross about 12 feet long and bolt that thing together and put it over his shoulder and walk carrying his cross. He'd go down the highway and people, he was famous because people would see him coming with that cross and they'd send out a news crew. Is this Jesus? What's going on? What are you doing? What's your cause? And he to preach Christianity, and it was kind of unique, you know, and he had his children, had twins, and the twins would go with him, and it was a big deal. He had a heart attack. The man had a heart attack. He went to the hospital, and I went to visit him. And I was worried that, you know, something happened to him. So I like to go every day, spend a few minutes or an hour or so. While I was there in the hospital with him one day, one of the roommates that he had was in a wheelchair, also had a heart problem. And I want to, you know, witness to him from the Bible. You call it da'wah, we call it witnessing. I'm going to witness to this man. Like Shaheed, you're going to give him your story. And I had my Bible and I tried to preach to him, and he told me, just, you know, like, leave me alone. I told him, I asked him, you know, your name, and he just said, Pete. I said, okay. And where are you from? He said, I'm from Mars. Well, in Texas, we have a place called Venus, Texas. So I thought, where's Mars, Texas? I don't know this place. But he was actually being a smart aleck with me, you know. And I tried to talk to him from the Bible about the story of Yunus alayhi salam, Jonah going in the whale, and how he had a lot of problems. And, you know, all humans have problems is a test. And he said, yeah, I understand what you're saying. And finally he said, I'm sorry I was a smart aleck with you. And he said, I have a confession to make to you. And I said, hold on, I'm a preacher. I'm not a priest. I don't do confession. Because in Catholic religion, every week you need to go to the priest. You sit in a room, a little tiny, tiny room next to him, and a little door in between, and you say, bless me, Father, for I have sinned. And he said, how long has it been since your last confession? And you tell him that, and then he said, tell me everything that happened since your last confession. And they confess everything. So, no, I'm not a priest. He said, I know. He said, I am. He said, I'm Father Peter Jacobs. And I was amazed. At what in the world? You know, this is a priest? Oh my God, I'm sorry. And he said, no, it's quite all right, you know. And we became friends. And then when I would go to visit, I would go and visit both my friend who was the born-again preacher and the priest in the same room. Same room. Amazing. So I decided this is my chance. So I will take my friend Muhammad over there, and there'll be a preacher, a born-again, and a priest in the same room. We'll have this guy. So I brought Muhammad into my little trap. You know what? My friend that was the cross, he didn't even want to talk to me. A Muslim? Oh. They wouldn't speak. The priest would talk to him, though. The priest was very nice. He would talk to him. And I found, by the way, the Catholic priests are some of the nicest people to talk to. Even they know about Islam and everything. They're the easiest of all of the religious leaders that I found. There's others too, but I found a lot of them to be pretty good. And I have some videotape of it, but that's not our subject right now. It happened next that the priest got out of the hospital and he had nowhere to go. So I contacted him, invited him to come and live with us out there in the country in my dad's big house, and he accepted and he came. Now I've got Muhammad living with us, and he's in our house, and now I've got a priest living with us. We're not Catholic, we're Protestant. My father's an ordained minister, so, you know, this is something. I'm preaching Christianity. All of us are in some kind of business except the priest, you know. So it seems like we can get something going here. And sure, we can get this poor Muslim out of this dumb thing that he must be in and get him to the right way. So every night we will sit around the table, and I'm going to explain to him through, you know, the Bible, what's the right way. My father, of course, he has his Bible. In fact, my father had many Bibles. I still have them. And my father has the King James Version that he likes. But I had Revised Standard Version, which doesn't have the same verses in it. And it's saying that King James has too many mistakes. Grave errors is the term that it uses with reference to King James. And the publishers have already made another translation of King James. It's called the New King James Version of the Bible. Then my wife has another version. I think she had something like the Good News for Modern Man Bible, or else I had one too, I don't know. And the priest, he's sitting there, he has another Bible. The Catholic Bible has 73 books in it. The Protestant Bible has 66. You don't even have to ask, is it the same book? If you don't even have the same books in it, never mind. There's no argument here, is there? And so we're trying to discuss Bibles, and our friend from Egypt is just sitting there smiling. We sit there after a meal at night and we're talking to him. It was not one night, many nights we were trying to, you know, show him the light of Christianity. And we would get into it, and then finally I asked him, I said, well, let me ask you about that book you got, that Koran thing that you have. How many versions is there of that? He said, actually, it's only in the Arabic. If it's translated, it's not considered the Quran anymore. So in the Arabic, there's only one, and we have the original. So what? He didn't say what, just keep going. He didn't say that. He did not say what I'm asserting. And if he did, he's lying. It's not possible. How, when we have 5,000, over 5,000 different copies or manuscripts, none of them are exactly alike, but they all confirm that there was an original. That's one of our stories. And that the Bible is not exactly the Word of God. It's the inspired Word of man from God. All kind of answers we have like that. But this man just said, we have it. That's it. What happened? We have the Quran. What? He didn't say that. I was talking to the priest one time about this subject. Just he and I are discussing the subject. He said, actually, we know about Islam. I said, how? He said, it's something that we have to study as priests. And since then, I've met many priests that confirmed the same thing. In fact, when I was in Karachi, Pakistan, I met Father, his name is Father D'Souza, who is the priest and the director of the high school at St. Patrick's Cathedral in Karachi. And I have him on tape with a videotape, and we made a program there. And he said that he holds a degree, a PhD in Christianity, doctor of Christianity, but he's a double doctorate. He has his other doctorate in Islam. And you can listen to the tape for yourself and hear the mistakes he makes about Islam, and I will tell you, he makes a mistake about Christianity. I don't see how he has a degree in either one. But that's the same thing that the Catholics have been studying Islam since Islam came. And by the way, it's amazing. And that's the subject of priests and preachers coming to Islam. You're listening to Islam tomorrow. We're broadcasting live all the way from the mosque, Masjid, here in Flint, Michigan. If you just came online and you don't know what's going on, I'll just tell you that we're talking about the subject of priests and preachers that enter Islam. And we're trying to determine why that happens. What is this phenomenon, and where are we going with that? And for a rebroadcast of this and other programs, you can visit our internet websites at islamtoday.com. I'm sorry, old habit. islamtomorrow.com and adly.net, adly.net. I mentioned to you that all of this came at a time when I had a lot of other things going on in my life. I was really being tested by Allah, but I really felt like I wanted to honestly and openly preach Christianity, to preach the message of God, and get as close to God as I could. And if I could have found clothes like this white thobe and so on, at that time I probably would have worn it because I wanted to be like Jesus. I did, because I thought he was such a great and wonderful person, and I still believe that as a Muslim, I have no doubt about that, and that if I could be like him, I would like to do that. And that is how I felt at that time, and still do. The priest asked Muhammad if he could go with him and visit the Muslim church, the mosque. So Muhammad agreed, and they went. And when the priest came back, we took him aside and we said, okay, what do? You know, did they like sacrifice chickens or kill little, you know, goats or something? Or, you know, what kind of strange things did they do? He said, actually, some men came in the afternoon and they stood in a row and they prayed and then they left. He said, and nothing else. I said, what kind of music did they have? He said, they didn't have any music. Now, I was one of the businesses I had was pianos and organs, and we had stores that sell musical instruments. Pianos and organs was our mainstay. We had Estes Piano Company, Estes Organ Company, and Estes Music Studios, and so that was a big deal to me. And I said, how in the world are you going to worship God without any music? Well, that didn't even make any sense.